Hello. This is the first of a short series of videos on some topics to do with seeing and vision. It's made from the standpoint of embodied cognitive science, and it will find puzzles and perplexities in generally received notions of seeing, which might help in opening up the topic somewhat. When we're talking about seeing, the word comes with very many connotations. Some of these reduce or contract, as it were, to theories of vision, which is understood as a sense. But we use the word seeing with implications far beyond any pre-given notion of perception. We use seeing to describe direct apprehension of, for example, the truth of a mathematical proof, or when we directly see in the sense of come immediately to recognize or intuit something. We use the word seeing in ways which go far beyond the presumed architecture of mind, which would see perception as distinct from cognition. Because when we see, we are making sense of our environment, coping with the environment, and we are seeing as sense-making beings with our complete understanding always on, as it were. Contraction of the notion of seeing to a mode of perception does some violence to this, and we leave some of these senses of seeing behind. We're going to, in these videos, consider two principal approaches to theories now of vision. One of these I will call imagistic, and one I will call relational. So let's consider them in turn. Under imagistic theories, I mean all those that depend upon the assumptions of most of what is called scientific psychology. It's worth putting in a parenthesis here. Associating the words science and psychology together suggests that we might have a scientific psychology which had the ring of truth. That will not be the position taken here. Psychological theories typically assume the brain to play a distinguished role in bringing into being or supporting cognition. And cognition is usually understood as involving perception and then judgment, thinking, higher cognitive faculties, and then the control of behavior. This approach is entirely optional, but it is so widespread, so baked into everyday conversations, that it needs to be understood for what it can and cannot tell us about ourselves. On such approaches, it is assumed that there is an external world and that the seeing subject comes to know that external world through input to the eyes. And this input somehow informs the brain. The brain is seen as the locus of consciousness, the locus of cognition, the driver of cognition. The brain plays a huge, huge, distinguished and decidedly non-biological kind of role here. These theories are resolutely neurocentric, and they contain within them paradoxes and puzzles, which might lead us to treat them with a certain suspicion. But as I said, they are so baked in to our self-understanding that we can't help but think about ourselves in these terms. Against imagistic theories, there's a separate corner of the world for relational theories of perception. These are most associated with the name of James J. Gibson and the School of Ecological Psychology. A terribly named school for, on my view anyway, it has nothing to do with ecology, which is much messier than the simple view of environment and animal taken in this field, and has absolutely nothing to do with psychology, which I understand as soul science, but you can make your own view up. Relational theories, as they are currently formulated, are resolutely behaviorist. We will encounter them occasionally in what follows, but our principal target will be the puzzles and paradoxes underlying imagistic theories. There are other approaches, other ways in which the word seeing is contracted to a perceptual modality. The sensory motor correspondence theory of O'Regan and Noe is a famous one from 2001, but we'll just lump that in with relational theories here. And there is currently a vogue for computational vision. Now, from the standpoint taken here, this will have nothing whatsoever to do with seeing. It is the fairly well-defined task of mapping from digital images, which we will have questions about, to text, to labels and words. So identifying, recognizing, spewing out a label, cat, for example, when there is a cat in a picture. This is a hugely important field. It plays a big role in our lives, but it has nothing to do with the view of seeing that is being queried here. So what I'm going to do now is just do a very short experiment to give you a flavor of what's coming. And then we're going to just mention or provide a map for the six following videos. So for this experiment, I'm going to ask you, as every psychologist does when a subject comes into their lab, to sit, stare, and look at the fixation cross. You wouldn't be surprised if you were asked to do this and you were a subject in a psychology experiment. It's also something you're asked to do prior to the demonstration of very many optical illusions. So, assuming you're sitting and staring at a screen, you can see the cross. Let's agree, for now, you can see the cross. I don't think that's a problem. So, what I'm going to ask you to do is to leave your eyes on the cross. Don't bother moving your eyes. You can relax them a little if you like, but I want you to leave your eyes where they are and just notice how much else you're seeing. There is, around the cross, an entire manifestation. The cross doesn't exist in a void, it exists within something. Some people talk of a visual field here, but we'll have reason to critique that notion as well. But for now, let's just call it the manifestation. You're staring at the cross, you undoubtedly see the cross, but look at everything else you see. That'll suffice for now. In the six coming videos, the first we'll examine a majorly discredited theory of seeing, going back to Plato. Very venerable roots, but it's the old extramissive theory of vision, in which seeing is supported by rays coming out of the eyes, an entirely improbable notion, but great fun to think about, and not unimportant when we consider its counterpart, intramissive theories of vision. The second video will return to that fixation cross, and we'll look at the business of fixing subjects prior to conducting experiments which claim to investigate vision. The third video will be perhaps a little niche. It will take two readily distinguishable capacities of the visual system and show that they can be seen as distinct and they can also be seen as the same thing, depending on how one views them. These are the vestibular ocular reflex and the ability of the viewing subject to smoothly follow an object moving in its environment, something called smooth pursuit tracking. For the fourth video, we're going to go way back in the history of media and look at how tubes and frames have influenced our seeing. Tubes specifically, we will speak of in reference to microscopes and telescopes, both of which are tubes. And frames, we'll talk about linear perspective, picture frames, photographs, digital images, and screens. In the fifth video, we'll be interested in how we see, how we consider that others see us. We'll have a lot to say about the topic of mirrors and specular surfaces, and about the role of faces, particularly in social coordination. The last video then will turn to the interesting and rich topic of time, in which we'll ask about how our approach to time influences how we think seeing works, and how seeing can reveal a specific kind of embedding in time. So those are the topics to be pursued. Perhaps they're of interest to you, but if not, thanks for dropping by anyway.